Pour out your power and love as we sing. how I timed that just perfect. Did you see that? How that ended and then I was already here. I've been working on that for 2 years now. You know? So, couple things going on. Baptism service, July 2nd. By the way, before I get going, I want to welcome you all. If you're visiting with us, I'm so glad you're here. If you have been here a few Sundays in a row, I'm glad you're here. And if you've been here forever, God bless you. I'm so glad you're here as well. July 2nd, baptism service. Always a good time, amen? Always a good time to see people really show an outward focus of who they are and what they want to do and how they want to live their lives for Christ. And it's a beautiful time. July 6th to the 8th is the Youth Canoe Trip. So please be praying for us. Thank you all for giving, as I've said before. Thank you for praying. But Dylan Bosch and I sat down Friday, and we kind of lined out the devotional time, and it was so cool how God worked in both of us on my front porch, and the things that was on his heart were on my heart and vice versa, and we worked this whole thing out. And I just want you to know that if you have a youth going to this, or if you know a youth who's going, be ready, that when they come back, we're praying that God does something so powerful in them. And I know, I talked to Dylan. I said, man, we've been talking so much about the devotional time, which is the focus on it. Man, we get to canoe too. Does anyone like to canoe, kayak? Anyone in here be on the river? It's a good time. It's a fun time. So I get to enjoy the fun too. July 22nd, I have 16 tickets downloaded on my phone for this game. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. Please, guys and boys, if you want your son to go with you, this is going to be a good time. No offense by this, but this is going to be a good time to get away from the church and hang out together as men, as boys, and just fellowship, have a pop and a hot dog, and just chill out and watch the game. And please come to that. If you're at all thinking about it, or if you're out here thinking, man, I can't stand baseball, then just come for the fellowship. Come and hang out, and we just have a good time together. We'll meet here at 4 o'clock. We're going to carpool down. I thought about getting a bus. What do you think about that, guys? Huh? We're just bouncing around down there, all comfortable. The driver always has the best seat on those things. But anyway, I decided no bus. Let's all just carpool, and then when we get down there, we'll fellowship. So if you're thinking about it, please sign up. $40 a ticket. Great evening for us guys. So Danny's been ministering out of Acts. He started last week, and one thing he said last week that spoke to me, the book of Acts is still being written today. What is being written about us? Man, that was like, boo, that spoke so loud. That's being written about us corporately as a body, and it's being written about us individually, you know? And one thing that Dylan and I were talking about that really fits well here is in Colossians chapter 3, starting in verse 14, says, in addition to all these things, put on love, which is perfect bond of unity. Let the peace of Christ, to which you indeed called in one body, rule in your hearts and be thankful. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. So what's being written about us? What's being written about us as a church? What's being written about us individually? And man, I want to run this race with everything I've got, and I want to run this race with you. And I want that, what's being written, to be good job, well done, good and faithful servant. You as a body, you as an individual, I want that written about me, about us. So I love you all. I'm glad we're here together. I'm glad we get to worship him. I'm glad we get to hear an amazing word this morning about what's being written. What does this look like? Let's pray. Lord, we love you. Father God, let us run this race with endurance. Let us run this race with passion, with love and joy. Let us run with everything inside of us. And Father, as I pray that, I pray in Jesus' name that we run together, that we run hooked arms, as we're running down this path of life, Father, that we see others that might be struggling, that we hook arms with them, that we can pick people up as we go, and we can run with everything we've got. So Lord, this morning, we run to you. No matter how our week has been, we have a moment of time right now to where we can stop and we can give everything to you. We can stop, we can listen to your voice, we can hear your Holy Spirit speak, we can just stop and listen. And I pray in Jesus' name this morning that we stop. Sometimes in this race, part of the race is listening to you. It's hearing your voice. And Lord, I pray that those in here are encouraged this morning. I pray a blessing over each and every one. I pray that we're able to listen to you. So Holy Spirit, you are so welcome. We ask that you move in this place like a rushing river, and that you just take us away. Touch my brother this morning as he brings the word. Lord, flow right through him, speak through him. And Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Well, good morning. If you'll stand and greet one another today.
Faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leads.
the same God today, yesterday. He'll be the same God forever. You will keep your covenant.
You don't know what we'd do without the rock of our salvation. Amen. Without the Lord, it would be, I just can't even imagine trying to do life in this world. I want to spend a few moments this morning as a congregation, just different ones of you, stand up where you're seated and pray. Pray for this service, maybe pray for different things that we know are going on. And let's just spend a little time together crying out to the Lord. So we're just going to wait, and if you feel led, stand up and pray.
We just want to follow you, Lord, and to know your heart, and to be your hands and feet, Lord. And sometimes we don't know what that looks like, but Lord, just help us to trust you through all of it, through the pain, through the struggles, through the joy. Just, Lord, help us to remain in your arms through everything.
Jesus, I just pray and ask that everybody in this congregation will feel the glory of you shining down on them and touching them inside their heart, down into their soul, that they may go out and speak the joy of you throughout everywhere they go and touch somebody else's life and let them see the joy shine through them.
Suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind that filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and to speak with tongues as the Spirit.
I love the verse, God, love one another, for love is from God. I feel your love here. Lord, help us just to be like the book of Acts, that we would forgive each other our wrongs, whoever has anything against each other. We would step forth this day. We would have the unity of your Holy Spirit, God, yes. That's being poured out, that love that connects each of every one of us, because it's your Spirit living in us, making us one, Lord. We thank you, God. I thank you for every person here today. Every person here has such value and such a part of you living in us, God, to give out. We have stuff to give each other. Help us not to hold back in our friendships with each other and just pouring love that comes from God on each other. Thank you, Lord.
Someone else?
Father, this is a holy moment of being in your presence. In the name of Jesus, our King and our wonderful Savior, and the love of the Spirit of God. And I pray this morning, Lord, that every person here, every person watching, would be encouraged, would be strengthened from within through the power of the Spirit of the living God, in Jesus' name, that your love, Lord, would melt our hearts. Remove the calluses, Lord. Remove the hardness. Remove the complacency, Lord. Fill our hearts again with a holy passion for our King. Lord, would you use your word today, even as we're looking at how you worked in the early church, may that be true of how you work here, and true awakening, true revival, true fire would begin to burn here and burn up the wood, hay, and stubble of our lives, Lord, that we might be men and women of God who don't try hard, but who are walking in the Spirit and experiencing their King and at a level that just splashes on people. So Jesus, come. Use your word to train us and to equip us and to get us on track. Use your word to inspire us, to light a fire in us. Lord, may you, the living word, meet us even as you're here right now. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Wow. You have your Bibles. We're in Acts chapter 1. That was a special moment for us this morning. And that's part of the sense of what happened in the early church when God was moving and they were all in a sense of awe, and Pastor Aaron will be talking about that next week. But last week, as we began the study, as we were looking at the book of Acts, and even as Pastor Aaron shared this morning, that the Acts are still being written, the Acts of the church, the Acts of the Spirit within us. And the question I asked last week at the end is, what is going to be written about us as a church in this day, in this culture, in 2023? And I don't know about you, but man, I believe and I have an anticipation we haven't seen anything yet. I have an anticipation and an excitement and a belief that God wants to do so much more than what we're experiencing now. Because he's the living God. He is not dead. He is has all authority, all power, and he's for us, and he literally says he'll walk with us to the end of the age. So I believe all things are possible, and that's what Jesus said. Everything's possible for those who believe. Can you imagine? I just believe as God begins to open the curtain of heaven to us, and as he begins to open the understanding of not just knowing the written word, but knowing the living word, knowing what it means to be people of the Spirit, knowing what it means to realize it's not about me trying hard to be good or trying hard to be religious, but walking with the one who is perfect, the one who is lovely, the one who is wonderful and beautiful, the one who's paid it all. And it's made possible because he's going to send the helper. And that was the promise last week that we were looking at, is that Jesus says, I want you to wait in Jerusalem for the promise from my Father that the Spirit of God will come. And I don't know about you, but I can understand this a little bit because I wasn't raised in the church. So for somebody to tell me, hey, the Spirit of God's going to come, I'd be like, okay, what's that look like? What's that mean? Because I had no idea. I'd never been in the church. I didn't understand how God worked and how it wasn't just trying to be a good person. I didn't understand any of that. But God has promised to come and make his home within us through the Spirit of God. When you have the Spirit, you have the Father and you have the Son. And Jesus says, wait for that time when the Spirit will come. Wait for the promise. And it says they left the Mount Olivet and they went into Jerusalem, went into the upper room. And it's interesting to me, but I don't know about you, but I'm not a very good waiter. How about you? Are you good at waiting? All you got to do is get in traffic and have to wait, and you'll find out you're not. Right? I'm horrible. I have a doctor's appointment for 9:20. I go to the doctor, and I get there 15 minutes early like a good guy is supposed to do, just in case I get in early. But usually it's an hour later. I'm not very good at waiting because I'm like, I have an appointment, 9:20. And at 9:20, I'm the guy that walks up and says, so how long is it going to be? Well, there was an emergency, and so we're not quite sure. And so then I have to make a decision. Am I going to sit in that room, depending on how sick I am or what's going on in my life, or am I going to say, you know, we probably should reschedule? You know why? Because I'm not patient unless God gives me patience. I'm not a good person at waiting. Now, I imagine here it says for 40 days Jesus appeared to them, showed them many convincing proofs and signs of who he was, and at one time he appeared to 500 at one time, and so for 40 days this has been going on. They watched Jesus to be taken up in front of them, and then he says, wait. And so this first section we're looking at is how they waited. And it's interesting because it says down here, chapter 1, verse 14, that says, these all had, with one mind, were continually devoting themselves to prayer, along with the women
and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers, in Matthew 13, 55, names Jesus' brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas, are his brothers. And in when he was in Nazareth, it says, and his sister. So they had many other kids, as we see here, but they were all in the upper room. And I'm sure in this upper room, it included Lazarus and Mary and what's the sister's name, Martha? They all were there, right? And so in Luke 8, it names several other women that actually worked and helped with the ministry. And so it literally says down here in verse 15, it says, at this time, Peter stood up in the midst of the brethren, a gathering of about 120 persons was there together. So there's 120 people in this upper room, and they're praying, they're waiting 10 days. Because Spirit doesn't come till Pentecost. Pentecost is the Feast of Weeks, which is means 50th, so it's 50 days after Passover. They waited for 10 days in an upper room. I'm not even very good at being sick, sitting in my chair at home, doing nothing. Can't imagine waiting. They're praying. How long can you pray? You ever done it? I went on a 10-day prayer journey. That was a stretch down in South America. And I had all sorts of anxiety about going on this prayer journey because I'm thinking 10 days, praying, walking, praying, walking, praying. And God moved powerfully, and it was an awesome experience. But they're 10 days. The Spirit hasn't fallen on them yet. And so something happens. Peter stands up in their midst and says, you know, this thing that happened to Judas, it was prophesied actually in Psalms, and goes through the whole thing. And I don't have time to go through the whole story because I got other things I want to get to. But they said, we have to replace him. So they do this cool thing where they pick out two guys, Matthias, and I think it was, let me see who the other guy was. As we went through this, come down. It's Joseph called Barsabbas and Matthias. So they had two guys who had been a part of Jesus' baptism, two disciples, all the way through his crucifixion and so on. And they said, we need to replace Judas. My thought in this is, Jesus didn't tell them to do that. He gave them orders to do one thing, wait. You ever thought about that? You ever get ahead of God? You ever, you know, kind of pray about something, but you're like, okay, I don't know how I feel about this, but I'm just going to do it. And then you say, oh, God, please bless this after the fact. You ever done that? I have. And been convicted about it. But so I really believe they're in here. They're trying to do something that Jesus had handpicked the 12. And so they cast lots. Casting lot is equivalent to flipping a coin. Heads, it's Matthias. Tails, it's the other guy. Well, it ends up being Matthias. They choose him. Do you know that this is the only place in the whole Bible you hear about Matthias? Nowhere else is his name mentioned. You never hear about Matthias again. Not that he was a bad guy. I'm sure he was a great guy. He was a disciple of Jesus. He's a follower of Jesus. But he wasn't handpicked by Jesus. Later, as we'll see, God handpicks Saul, who becomes Paul, who writes a lot of our New Testament that we have here. We hear a lot about him. But it's unique to me that I realize in my life there's times I've gotten ahead of God. Not that he wasn't calling me to something, but I was ahead of him. And he often allows things to happen, so I learn that, and I end up in the place that he wants me eventually. But this is an interesting story to me because of how it unwraps. But I want to jump into chapter 2 as we look at what I call the promise. So today we're looking at we looked at the wait, the promise. We're going to look at the prophecy. We're going to look at several different things as we run down through here. We're going to be looking at the proof and then the response. So in chapter 2, listen to what happens. And I love it that Bill read this morning. It says, when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And we kind of learned from verses 14 and 15, there was about 120 people that were hanging out and waiting in this. And it goes on and says, and suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were staying. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. And so there's some things here that I think are interesting. Through the years of going to church, when I first got saved and everything, people used to tell me, Danny, God only speaks in a still, quiet voice. It's funny how we grab on to passages and texts, and this becomes all that God does. Well, I'm going to tell you, I think God shows up with a great loud voice sometimes. Sometimes it is still and quiet, and sometimes it's loud. Here is a mighty rushing wind. I mean, it was loud, and we're going to see that because the people that were in Jerusalem around there heard it as well and came running. But when you think about it, God doesn't always come in a still, quiet voice. In fact, he made very clear, told you to wait for the coming of the Spirit, and he made sure they didn't miss it. Every single one of them knew the Spirit had come. Every single one of them got filled, baptized with the Holy Spirit. This is a promise that John talked about in Matthew chapter 3, starting in verse 12, where he said, I baptize you with water, but the one who's coming after me, who I'm not worthy to untie his sandals, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. There's some things here that I think are interesting that I want to talk about just as we get into this. Is this kind of a motley crew of apostles and people. These were kind of the people in the culture, the religious culture would have said, they're not good enough. These are some of the people that were healed from demon possession. These are some of the people that were healed from diseases and sickness. These are the ones that the religious looked at as outcasts with God, and God is pouring out his Spirit. You know, in chapter 4 of Matthew, where it speaks in there that the great light had dawned in Galilee of the Gentiles in the valley of the shadow of death, meaning the kingdom, the king had come. And he came in a place and in a way that nobody expected him to come. And now he's conferring his kingdom upon these men and these women that are gathering. There was 120 left. Have you ever thought about that? 120 left in that upper room that are actually waiting for what Jesus said would come. That the counselor, the helper, the spirit of love, agape, is going to come and fill you with me. You understand that the coming of the Spirit is the birth of the church, but it's also the birth of the kingdom on earth through his children, his disciples, his beloved, us. And the kingdom of God had come, and he came with great power. He came without any doubt, and the Spirit came as a fire, as tongues of fire that separated and rested on each one. You remember in the baptism of Jesus where the Spirit came down in the form of a dove and John the Baptist saw it and it remained on Christ? And that Spirit that remained on Christ, the dove, represented that he's the Lamb of God who's going to take away the sin of the world. He's the sacrifice. And the Father spoke and said, this is my Son who I'm well pleased. I receive you. I receive you as a sacrifice. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And Jesus spoke in Matthew chapter, or John chapter 14 and following, where he just said, when the Comforter comes, you will do greater things than these. How? Because God himself is going to live and abide in us. How about if we start believing it? How about if we get hungry enough to say, Lord, I want to see you do that in and through the body of Christ. I want to see you stretch your hand out in our day and do signs, wonders, and miracles, not for me, but for your name's sake, for your glory, for your honor, for your blessing. Lord, you're so worthy. Do you realize the kingdom of God came to set the captives free? Us. Those who were enslaved to sin, to release them from the bondages of their sin, to release them from the captive of our sin, the devil, the enemy of our souls. He came to set us free. The kingdom of God is here in great power and glory if we allow it. We're part of the living temple. We're part of the royal priesthood. We're children of the light. Spirit lives within us if you're in Christ. And I think about this day, how awesome it had to be for several reasons. You know, when we talk about these apostles, they were a group of guys who were literally arguing on the Last Supper with Jesus, the Passover, when he's telling them about his body and his blood, and they were arguing about who's the greatest. They were still fighting with each other about these kind of things. But the Spirit has come. And it's amazing. You don't see them fighting anymore about those kind of things. You might see them confront one another about pulling back and being afraid that the Jews would be upset with you. But you don't see them fighting over who's the greatest and who's the best and over issues and weird things. We see God begin to bring a unity of the people that are diverse, because in there you had zealots and you had Sadducees and you had Pharisees and different kinds of scribes that were coming from different backgrounds, and they come together, and through the power of the Spirit, God begins to build his church. He's still building it. He's still working. Listen to what it says. It says, now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. That's a lot of nations. And when this sound occurred, the crowd came together and were bewildered, because each one of them was hearing them speak in his own language. They were amazed and astonished, saying, why are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we each hear them in our own language to which we were born? This is a big deal. These Galileans spoke Koine Greek and whatever the Galilean dialect was, and you had people from every tribe, every nation there, who, when they heard the noise, came running with wondering, what in the world is happening? It must have been something. I mean, I've heard noises, and I kind of peek out the window, and like, I wonder what that is. Or transformer blows, and you're like, whoa, I think that was a transformer. But this noise was so distinct and so amazing that it captured people's attention, and they came running. It wasn't just a short deal. And then these people come running out of the upper room, speaking in different languages, literally. And I always wonder, and it kind of makes me think, because there's way more than you think people there with all these different kinds of languages. Was God just making it so they heard it in their... This is the way my mind works, okay? Was God making it so they just heard it in their own language? Or were they really literally speaking these different languages? It's both a miracle, right? But I think they were literally speaking all these different languages, and they were proclaiming the greatness of God, and they were hearing this, and they were wondering, what does this mean? What's happening? Whew. Can you imagine, just with me for just a moment, because I've seen this happen to a certain extent, when God starts moving so powerful somewhere, you know what starts happening? There's a noise that begins to come out of this fellowship that travels through the communities and the different towns and the different neighborhoods, and people start going, something's happening over there, and I need to come and see what's happening. And God just begins to grab hearts. I've seen it. He wants to do it here. And when the Spirit of God moves, there's a fire that starts burning, and that starts splashing over, and people feel drawn. I've had people just literally say, I felt drawn to come here today. And I'm like, oh man, God's going to get you. God's going to grab your heart. God's going to shake your world. And sure enough, by the end of the service, that person's at the altar crying out to the Lord for salvation. That is a miracle. Yeah. Only God can do that. We can make all sorts of noise. We can have really big, fancy everything, and it won't change anyone. But when the Spirit of God comes, look out. You know what happens when that happens? You can't wait to come back together as a body, because you want to know, what are you going to do today, God? How are you going to move among us today? I'm telling you, the Spirit of God lit these men on fire, lit these people, the 120, all that were there, on fire for the kingdom of God. They understood in their heart, this is my sole purpose, is to bring glory to Jesus, that people might see him and know him. I'm not going to read all of this. It goes on and says, and they continued in amazement in verse 12, and great perplexity, saying to one another, what does this mean? And it says, but others were mocking and saying, they are full of sweet wine. And Peter stands up among them, and he says this, and he raised his voice and declared, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give heed to my words, for these men are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only the third hour of the day." It's only 9 in the morning. And he's saying, they're not drunk, man. You don't get it. There's something so powerful that's happened. You got to hear. And listen to what he says. He quotes out of Joel. It says, "But this is what was spoken of through the prophet Joel, and it shall be in the last days." This is our day. Part of the last days. God says, that I will pour forth my spirit on all mankind. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my bond slaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor and smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come. And it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And here's the deal. When we went through Matthew, you remember Matthew 24, verses 29 through 31, this very thing was said at the end, just before Jesus came. At the very end of Matthew there, where it says this in verse 29 and following, and I'm just reading it from Acts again, and I'll grant wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below, blood, fire, vapor, and smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So he's saying from the time of my crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension, from the time of Pentecost to the day you see me come back in the clouds, I'm going to pour forth my spirit. Anybody happy about that besides me? I'm going to do wonders and works in your midst. I'm going to stretch out my hand if you believe in me. And it says, all those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be say, that is good news of great hope for us. So the Spirit is for us. And he goes on and he says this, "Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him and in your midst, just as you yourself know. This man was delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God. You nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death. But God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in its power." Jesus conquered death and Hades, and he holds the keys. Death has no victory over a believer now. The moment we die, we're in his presence. The moment we take the last breath here, it's the beginning of our life in the kingdom with God. Do you know the moment you gave your life to Christ, your kingdom journey began? You're a child of God. We're just going to know more when we get there. We're going to be fully known. We're going to fully know him. We're going to grow in our relationship with God. And this is what it's all about. And Peter's preaching a message saying, man, you killed him. You killed the Messiah. You killed the one who came to save us. And it was part of God's predetermined plan that before the foundation of the world, he had planned to send his son to die for the sins of the whole world. There's no other way to get to heaven. Jesus says it so clear, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And there's no way to the Father except through me. But do you understand that he's the King of Kings and he's just doing this? Come. All you who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me, I'll give you life. Come to me and drink from the river of life. Come to me and get your sins washed away. It says he casts our sin as far as the east and to the west and to the deepest sea. Whew. Anybody glad about that besides me? We will stand before God clean because of what he's done for us. Not because I'm good enough, not because you're good enough, because he is perfect and wonderful. And his love drove him to come here
to rescue you and me. Man, I love this. And he goes through a bunch of things showing the proof through this. And I want to get to this part in verse 33, and I got a little bit more to go, that says, therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. And it goes on down in 36, and it says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Paul was very clearly laying out who Jesus was and is and what he's done. And he's saying this. Listen to what he says as he gets into this, the response. He says, now, when they heard this, they were pierced to their heart. That's what should happen to us. And said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Did you hear that? Repent. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Turn to Jesus. Run to your Savior, your Redeemer, your Lord. Repent and run to Jesus, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Listen to what it says, verse 39. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off. As many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And he goes on and says, with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. So then, those who have received his words were baptized. And that day, there were added about 3,000 souls. And what I want to share with you here, one thing we're going to learn as we go through the book of Acts, every time people gave their life to Christ, you know what they did? They got baptized. They got a believer's baptism. You know why? You know why? Because it tells us in Luke 9:23 and following that we're supposed to deny ourselves, pick up our cross daily, and follow him. The idea is we're letting the whole world know Acts 1:8 is coming alive. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will receive power to do what? Testify about me. Everywhere you go. And the deal is baptism is one of the ways in which we testify that we belong to Jesus, just like the communion table. Listen, if you haven't had a believer's baptism, I'm just going to tell you, I don't believe it's an option. Every single time. I don't care if you were baptized as an infant. I don't care how. That's a great thing. That's a wonderful thing. Parents did, but it's not a believer's baptism. A believer's baptism is about you personally giving your life to Jesus Christ. And you're radically identifying publicly, because that's a testimony. You're testifying about his death, burial, and resurrection. You're saying to everybody, I belong to Jesus. He's my king. He's my Lord. We're going to be having this baptism come up July 2nd. And if you've never had a believer's baptism, it's for you. Every single person who gives their life to Christ, and we're going to see it over and over, even those who are baptized by John the Baptist, for repentance of their sins, getting ready for the coming Lord, even those, when they gave their life to Christ and understood who Jesus was and repented and turned to him, got baptized. Why? In their culture, it was totally done publicly. So everybody would see, oh, he's one of them. Jesus says, if you're ashamed of me and my words, I'll be ashamed of you at the coming of my Father. Listen, we're supposed to live our life out loud for the kingdom, for the gospel. We're not to take our light and hide it under a bushel basket, right? It says we're set it out for everyone to see. The 10 virgins, the idea of lighting your lamp and putting it out is to say that I belong to Jesus. And I'm not ashamed, not even a little. I want every single person to know that I belong to him. I want everybody to know he's the hope. I want everybody to know your sins can be forgiven. I want you to know that the kingdom of God wants to rescue you and deliver you and heal you and set you free. I want you to know him. We serve an awesome God. He promised the Comforter, and he's come. May we be a people who submit and yield to his leading. May we be a people who submit and yield to being on mission with the gospel of Christ, that we take Jesus everywhere we go, that we become the witness and the men and women of God that he's called us to be, not about religion, but about a real relationship with the King of the universe. Father, I pray in Jesus' name this morning that your Holy Spirit would come and move in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives, and that you would open up the kingdom to us, that you would open up the door of fellowship with you, Lord. We open the doors of our heart and invite you in, that you would come and dine with us and us with you, that we'd have that communion, that intimacy, that relationship that is so powerful. You didn't come to develop a church. You came to develop a people who are called by your name, who love you and honor you and walk after you and walk with you. Lord, bind the enemy from this place. Bind the enemy from us. Holy Spirit, have full reign and rule in our hearts, in our lives, in our minds. Set us on fire, Lord. Bring revival in this place. We love you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.
If you'll stand and join us in this last song. I can't wait for eternity. Join a song they're already singing.
I'm the guy that comes up after that. Wow. Worthy is the Lamb. God doesn't call the equipped, He equips the called. That's why I'm up here, because the Spirit of God is burning in my heart right now. Second Timothy 1:7. For God did not give us a spirit of fear or timid, but a spirit of power, of love, and self-discipline. So when you accepted Christ, ask for forgiveness, repent, start turning away from your sin, the Spirit of God goes to work in your heart, renewing your mind. And He equips us, encourages us, empowers us, which made me think of this right here. All of us are given spiritual gifts in some way, whether we're going to use them or not. But right here, we have equipment. We just have to be the hands and feet. So my prayer is the pews are cleaned out today. Because there's a lot of people hurting, a lot of people lost, living in darkness. And our job is to plant the seed. I don't know what seed's going to grow, but God's going to take care of that. He's the one that's going to grow them. So I just pray, Lord, that You would just touch our hearts, our minds. Empower us, equip us to go out and share about the love of Jesus, knowing that if somebody didn't do that to us, where would we be? We continue to be lost without You. So I just pray that Your Spirit would overwhelm us today. And again, we would just proclaim the love of Jesus in our communities, in our schools, in our work. Just pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.